plus the theory part of it, how to understand the making of the journal. For this today, we have got all the three committees are working under vice presidentship of us, that is Dr. Basav. We have got Vice President Dr. Basav with us. And for this, we would like Dr. Basav to kindly share a few words with us today. And
Thank you, Rakhi. It's a pleasure to address you on this occasion of Endolit series. It is difficult in this age of webinars to stand out and make a difference because you're in a very crowded environment. To stand out, one of the best ways would be to have the choicest of faculty, power-packed of them, and to have a very short and very crisp event. So I congratulate Dr. Rakhi leading the pack of Dr. Niharika and Dr. Kalyan. And so some wonderful committees of FOCSI have got together to bring this to you. And we have some wonderful faculty who's lined up to give you some good information, concise, precise, clinical, and something which would be useful for takeaways. So I congratulate Dr. Rakhi, Dr. Niharika, and Dr. Kalyan for conceiving this. I also thank the partners, Zydus Gynext, a very close company to ours, for supporting this program, Endolit, and for taking it through. So look forward to an excellent session now and in the events which are lined up in the near future. Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you, Dr. Basav. And for these events, we have got a complete chalked out program for it, and which is going to be launched every first of the month from 7 to 9. The timing is fixed. Kindly do log in. We've got Dr. Chamila, who is the senior guide to us. Can we have Dr. Chamila?
Thank you so much, Rakhi. Like as Basav said, you need some initiatives to stand up in a crowd, and adding research to academics, social work, as well as advocacy makes sense because you need to move forward. And for that, I think clinical research is the main thing you can do. And it's a great initiative of yours because you're quite hardworking. You've taken everything piecemeal, worked it out. And I think the entire program also has been chalked out along with the other committees, both the Public Awareness Committee by Kalyan as well as the Young Talent Research Committee by Niharika. And clinical research is actually about asking questions, and you need to search for answers which should be satisfactory, methodologically valid, and it should be also balanced. You cannot give one-off answers like that. You need to be very balanced in your view. And for that, this is a great initiative. And I think it will give us a great understanding of how to put up a research question, formulate a protocol, put up a study design and methodology along with the statistics. And I think you've got great faculty like Meena there, who's going to start the program. It's a great research lesson there. So I think this initiative will be go a long way to help FOCSI and help many more people to come into research. Thank you so much, Rati, for putting up this initiative. And most of us like are really passionate about research will, and I think enjoy most of the programs. Thank you so much for that.
Thank you, Dr. Chamila, who has been the past clinical research committee chairperson, and she is there. We're going to see her as a vice president in near future. Well, moving on ahead without wasting much amount of time, we've got, can we have our MOC's CV today so that we can move on with our program ahead? Next, please. Dr. Meenu Handa's CV, please. We've got Dr. Meenu, who is a senior consultant and unit head at Fortis Bloom Gurgaon and the course director of FOCSI Certified Infertility Course and Joint Secretary of Haryana ISAR, Joint Secretary of Haryana IAG. I hand over the session to Dr. Meenu Handa, who's going to take care of the further proceedings for this program. Dr. Meenu.
Thank you, Dr. Rakhi, for these kind words. And it's always a pleasure to work under your guidance. And moving forward, I would like to invite Dr. Samta Gupta for our first talk. Could I have the CV slide, please, Mohini? Dr. Samta Gupta is the current professor and senior consultant with the School of Medical Science and Research, Sharda Hospital at Greater Noida Ops, Greater Noida. She's also the treasurer, Greater Noida Ops Gynae Society. Over to you, Dr. Samta, for your first talk.
Thank you, Meenu ma'am. Good evening, everyone. First of all, I would like to share my screen. Okay. Is my screen visible?
Yes, yes, please.
So first of all, I would like to thank Dr. Rakhi, Jaideep sir, Dr. Kalyan, Dr. Niharika, Dr. Basap for giving me this opportunity to be a part of the Endolit series and being the first speaker. In an obstetrician's basket of drugs, progesterones take a special role. Obstetricians have a special affinity for these progesterones. We are fantasized by its various molecules, be it a diprogesterone, a natural micronized progesterone, or hydroxycapron. These form a part of our prescription day in and day out. But are we really using them correctly? So let's have a look on this research article, that is the PRISM trial, progesterone in spontaneous miscarriage. So this trial was published in May 9, 2019 in the New England Journal of Medicine, and the journal has got a very good impact factor of 74.7. It was a randomized trial of progesterone in women with bleeding in early pregnancy. So the basic objective of this trial was to investigate whether treatment with progesterone would result in higher incidence of live births among women with bleeding in early pregnancy in comparison to the placebo. Miscarriage affects 1 in 5 pregnancies. Progesterone is produced by the corpus luteum, and we all know that it helps in the support of the pregnancy because of its immunomodulatory effects. This physiological importance of progesterone has prompted researchers, physicians to consider its supplementation during early pregnancy to prevent miscarriages in women who have recurrent miscarriages and to rescue pregnancy who have started to bleed during the early pregnancy. A Cochrane review, which was published in 2007, and it was of 7 randomized trials and last updated in 2018. And the result was this, that the progestins, if they are given with the bleeding in early pregnancy, they show a significantly lower risk of miscarriages than the placebo. However, these trials were very small. The largest trial had a sample size of just 191 and had methodological weaknesses. Another Cochrane review, which was a review of 13 trials of progestational agents in women with recurrent miscarriages, and it was updated in 2018. The ACOG reviewed and concluded with this Cochrane review that for threatened early pregnancy loss, the use of progestins is controversial and conclusive evidence supporting their use is not very effective. However, women with at least 3 prior pregnancy losses may benefit from progesterone therapy in the first trimester. So the aim of this research study was to evaluate the role of progesterone as compared with placebo in women with vaginal bleeding in early pregnancy. So the material and methods, it was a multicentric randomized double blinded placebo controlled trial, and it was done in 48 hospitals in the United Kingdom. The study period was of 2 years, and the sample size was a very good sample size of 4,153 pregnant females. The females which were included were in the age group of 16 to 39 years who were less than 12 weeks of pregnancy and has presented with vaginal bleeding. And on the ultrasound scan, there was an intrauterine gestational sac. The upper threshold of 39 years was taken because, as we all know, that after 39 years, the risk of miscarriages due to chromosomal abnormalities is already high. The women who had on ultrasound scan the CRL of 7 millimeter or more with no fetal heart rate, or a mean sac diameter of 25 millimeter or more with no visible fetal pole were excluded. Then women with ectopic life-threatening bleeding, with current or recent use of progesterone supplementation, or who had contraindications to progesterone therapy like liver tumors, genital or breast cancers, they all were excluded from the study. Further, the randomization was done, and the random patients were randomly assigned in 1:1 ratio through a secure centralized internet facility. They were grouped into 2 groups. So the first group received 400 micrograms of micronized progesterone vaginally twice a day, and the other group had a matching placebo twice daily. The appearance, route, and timing of administration of both, be it a placebo or a progesterone, were identical, and this progesterone or a placebo were given till 16 completed weeks of gestation. They were further analyzed into the subgroups on the basis of maternal age, body mass index, presence or absence of fetal heart rate, estimated gestational age at presentation, how much was the amount of vaginal bleeding on the basis of pictorial blood assessment chart, multiple or a singleton pregnancy, race, is there any history of polycystic ovaries and previous cervical excision histories. The best part was that the participants, physicians, trial nurses, all were unaware of these trial group assignments. The primary outcome they measured was the birth of a live-born baby after at least 34 weeks, that is the patients who had completed 34 weeks of gestation. The other secondary outcomes they looked at were whether the pregnancy continued after 12 weeks, till what gestation the pregnancy continued, was there any kind of a miscarriage, a preterm birth, ectopic or a stillbirth, preeclampsia. Then regarding the neonatal outcomes, what was the APGAR score, the birth weight, whether it was average or small for gestational age or large, was there any presence of any congenital abnormalities, survival at 28 days of neonatal life, or any kind of a antenatal, intrapartum, postpartum, or a neonatal problem. A Poisson regression model to estimate the relative rates and 95% two-sided confidence interval was chosen for the statistical analysis. For the primary outcomes, a p-value was generated using a two-sided chi-square test. Similarly, for the various other subgroup analysis, a chi-square test was done to determine the various effects. Around 23,775 patients were assessed for this eligibility. Out of them, they found out that 12,862 were eligible. 4,553 underwent randomization. Rest of them declined to participate in the study. Then they were further grouped. So the progesterone group in number was 2,779 and the placebo were 2,074 women received the placebo. If you look at the demographic and the baseline characteristics of the participants in both the groups, progesterone and placebo groups, regarding the maternal age, BMI, race, so the baseline maternal characteristics were similar in both the trial groups. The important results regarding the primary outcome. So if we look at the live birth rates, the incidence of live births after at least 34 weeks of gestation was 75% in the progesterone group. That is, from 2,025 women, about 101.513 crossed the 34 weeks of gestation. And in the placebo group, it was 72%. So by these results, we can say that there was no significant difference and the p-value was not significant. And this data for the primary outcome was available from 95% of the female who were recruited for the study. The secondary outcome, if you look at the various secondary outcomes, the ongoing pregnancy rate at 12 weeks incidence was 83% in the progesterone group and 80% in the placebo, so no statistical difference. The incidence of miscarriage was 20% in the progesterone group and 22% in the placebo. Again, there was no statistical difference in these analyses. In the subgroup analysis, rest everything was same, but just have a look at the number of previous miscarriages. So we can find that there was a significant effect was identified in the subgroup in the number of previous miscarriages. So the women who had three or more previous miscarriages, the incidence in whom the progesterone supplementation was successful was 72% in comparison to the placebo group, in which it was 57%. So the p-value in this group was significant, that is 0.007. In the other adverse events, other maternal or neonatal outcomes, there was no significant difference between the two groups. And similarly, the neonatal congenital abnormalities, both were 3.4% in both the groups. The various strengths of this study was that it had a very large sample size in comparison to the various previous studies in which the sample size was less. Then the progesterone and the placebo were supplied from the same company and the company had no role in the design of trial in the collection analysis, so there was no chances of bias. Then various monitoring committees were made for the they were provided for the independent data and safety monitoring so that the bias was not there. However, there were some limitations in this trial. That is, the trial used vaginal preparation of progesterone, and it is possible that the results observed with this regime, we cannot generalize to all the women receiving the other preparations by the other routes. Secondly, in this trial, the treatment was given only to the women who have got an intrauterine G-sac. So even if the sac is not visible, this study does not provide any effects or evidence regarding the effects of the earlier use of progesterone. Thirdly, in this study, the progesterone supplementation was discontinued at 16 weeks of gestation because the authors felt that that the therapy beyond this time will not affect the outcomes related to miscarriages. Finally, although there was no increase in any kind of a congenital abnormality rate in these in the study treated with progesterone, however, the trial was not powered for such rarer outcomes. So the conclusion of this study was that among women with bleeding in early pregnancy, progesterone therapy administered during first trimester did not result in significantly higher incidence of live births than the placebo. The only advantage of giving progesterone in this study was in the females who have got recurrent miscarriages, three or more than three miscarriages. So time has come to change our practice as well as policies. So we all as our obstetricians should judge the case, and we should not injudicially prescribe progesterones where they can be avoided. So these are the references of the various of the article. Thank you very all for the patient hearing. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Samta, for nicely having this article read out for all of us to understand the PRISM trial. Can we have Dr. Jaideep Tank, with whom I had conceptualized this whole program and we're supposed to take out of it? Can we have Dr. Tank, sir, your verdict on it? Dr. Jaideep? I think he's busy a little bit. We'll move on, Meenu, for the next this thing. And once he's back, then we'll have his word from him.
Sure, Dr. Raki. So we now move on to our second talk, which is on understanding of multicentric randomized double-blind placebo-controlled trial. For this talk, let us invite Dr. Meena Samant, who is the chairperson of FOCSI Clinical Research Committee and Secretary General of ISOPAR. So welcome, Dr. Meena. Over to you for your next talk.
Thank you so much. And thank you, Dr. Raki, for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Okay. Is my screen visible?
Yes, Dr. Meena, you need to make it PowerPoint mode.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So this topic is really a mouthful, and I must tell you, it's not that simple as well to conduct it. Randomized control trial, an epidemiological experiment in which subjects in a population are randomly allocated into groups, usually called study, and the control groups to receive and not receive an experimental, preventive, or therapeutic procedure, maneuver, or intervention. And if we look at this hierarchy of evidence pyramid, RCTs, they come right at the top, and they're usually for, you know, answering the therapy and the diagnostic questions. So randomized double-blind controlled studies are considered as the gold standard of epidemiological studies. If well-designed, these studies provide the strongest possible evidence of causation. Clinical trials should be carefully designed, reviewed, and completed, and need to be approved before they are started. People of all ages can participate in clinical trials. And why we need to use this type of study is because good randomization will wash out any population bias easy-to-blind, masked, then observational studies, results can be analyzed with well-known statistical tools to approximate a controlled experiment, and populations of participating individuals are clearly identified. However, these types of studies are not without their own, you know, disadvantages. They can be very expensive in terms of time and money. There's a volunteer biases. This population that participates may not be representative of the way it's going to be applied, and loss to follow up. That is, attrition can be a major issue. And when we design such studies, this what it is going to look like. Have a study population, randomly give the allocation and the treatment and control, follow them up, and we get compare the results. Actually, Dr. Samta's presentation has made my work very easy, because it was a randomized placebo-controlled trial. And now that I'm going to talk about it, it's going to become even more clearer. So the comparison arm, we have a placebo. What placebo basically is, an inactive drug or treatment used in a clinical trial. It is sometimes referred to as a sugar pill also. And placebo-controlled trials compare a new treatment with this. Now, placebo effect is a psychosomatic effect brought about by relief of fear, anxiety, or stress because of the study participation. Component of every specific treatment effect can be attributed to placebo response, and no treatment is not the same as placebo treatment. Use of placebo controls in patients who have an active disease for which there is an approved treatment is ethically questionable. We would only use placebo when there is no other treatment possibly available. Use of active or historic controls in clinical studies may address these ethical questions. So what are the ethics and guidelines regarding placebo? The Office of Human Research Protection published a guideline in 2008 for the use of placebo and methods to minimize the risk associated with it. The guideline states placebo may be used in clinical trials where there is no known or available, that is FDA-approved alternative therapy that can be tolerated by the subject. The use of placebos in controlled trials must be justified by a positive risk-benefit analysis, and the subjects must be fully informed of the risks involved in the assignment to the placebo groups. And here is one example of RCT, which was again a multicentric randomized, but a non-inferiority. Here, the study that tests whether a new treatment not worse than an active treatment is being compared. Non-inferiority trials are sometimes done when placebo or the inactive treatment cannot be used, because just like I mentioned, there are ethical issues when you can treat it with some known available treatment. To refuse that, to deny that treatment would have an ethical influence. So when we are not able to go for a placebo control trial, a non-inferiority trial is an option. Now, what about randomization? Now, this is done only in the interventional studies, the RCTs. All confounders get distributed equally in all the groups. As was shown in the previous study, all the demography were well matched. It produces the comparable group and eliminates the source of bias in the treatment assignments. Neither the patient nor the physician knows in advance which therapy will be assigned. Each patient has the same chance of receiving any of the treatments, be it placebo or the treatment group under study. And there are so many ways of, randomizing the study. There are random number tables. There are simple randomizations and the computer-based. This is showing the block randomization so that you get some representative from each block. Then these are the stratified randomizations so as to ensure that all kinds of different stratas are included in the study. So this is about this. And of course, online randomization can be done. There are various softwares that can generate a randomization plan for the study. Now coming to concealment, that is blinding. factors that can affect the evaluation of outcome should not be permitted to influence the evaluation process. And we know that there are three types of randomization: single, double, and the triple. Single, where the patient is concealed about the type of therapy they're getting. So why the patients need to be blinded is because patient who knows that they're receiving a new or experiment treatment may report either more or less side effects. It's the human psyche. Patients not on new experimental treatment may be more or less likely to drop out of the study. And patients may have preconceived notions about the benefits of the therapy. And patients try to get well or try to please their physicians by, you know, saying that they're quite well. And of course, we all know there is always a placebo effect of any drug. Then double blinding is where neither the investigator nor the participants know that the group allocation and the treatment received. However, the statistician knows it. The code numbers are given and only the statistician would know. And we know as a treating physician, we always have a bias towards getting good results, especially if we have a preconceived notions about them. So our study would be, the title given to me is double blind. And actually these are the types of blinding that are mostly used in the RCTs. However, we know that it may not always be possible to do a blinding, or it may be unethical also. A treatment may have characteristic side effects, and that makes it even very obvious what the what arm it is. And it may be difficult to blind a physician if you're testing some kind of a device or surgery. So again, here a blinding would not be able to be done. Now, this is one example, the INFORM trial, which was where two districts hospitals in Nagpur had conducted this study, Foley's catheterization versus oral misoprostol for induction of laser for labor in hypertensive women in India. Here again, blinding was not done, maybe because, you know, it was so obvious, the Foley's, and the one was a application, another was taking a pill. Now, but why a metacentric? According to site allocation of a clinical trial or study, it can be single center, a multi-site, or a multicentric. In multicentric trials, the investigator at the sites are involved in the study from designing level and participate as co-investigators in the study. Each one of them is scientifically responsible for the result of the study and participate in the manuscript and other dissemination activities as well. So multicentric involvement has an extraordinary positive impact on recruitment into a clinical trial. Multi-center studies increase the applicability of findings across a wide spectrum of settings because you're including all kinds of patients, many different, people from different places. A well-planned and executed trial can generate robust results that change clinical practice, unlike small studies which produce uncertain results. Clinical studies are designed to assess if interventions make a difference to clinically relevant outcome. And this is what it is like. This is taken from accrued rate from the LUNA trial. Here in the initial pilot phase, we can see the induction is pretty low, but once the multi-center phase has started, the cumulative recruitment is very good, and rather it's reached what they were wanting, which is often which is desirable and often not happening in single center or single hospital studies. Here again is the multi-center collaboration on recruitment target, multi-centric prep study. Here the initial pilot study, you can see there hardly any, very few, but once the multi-centric has started, the recruitment goes pretty well. And again, the timely recruitment is there, and also generalizability of findings based on multi-center clinical trial compared to a single study. So both all centers, they all get together and you get to get the result in a better way. So just looking at the history a little bit, historically, the first multicentric trial is a trial investigating cure of common cold, which is less known actually about this trial. In the 1940s, Lancet published case series and a controlled single center trial about the promising effect of Patulin, a derivative of penicillin, Patulum, against the common cold. So they wanted to go ahead with the mass production, but it was the World War II time and the resources were scarce. So before going in for the mass production, the Therapeutic Research Corporation, they approached Medical Research Council to direct a trial on a larger scale to investigate the drug's true effectiveness. And it so happened that Patulinum did not demonstrate any benefit in treating common cold, but it served as a model for better known subsequent multicentric clinical trial investigating the use of streptomycin for tuberculosis. So how to plan a multicenter trial? Just briefly, I'll touch upon it. First, you have a pre-planning stage when a pilot study is conducted. The process of planning a multicentric clinical trial can be thought of as an analogy. They are smaller scale undertaken to augment the conduct of future related investigation in a stepwise fashion. There are basically two pilots. It could be external or internal studies. And they typically smaller scale and test pilot runs the planned larger scale study. Many granting agencies require the proof of study feasibility and error margins for investing funds for the full trial. First of all, one would have to arrange grants if a study needs extra funds. It is important as multicentric study, numbers of patients is pretty large and research teams are established. Additional collaborative centers are recruited, institutional ethical committee approvals would be needed, and from all the institute, all the centers that are involved, the protocols and study designs, including the manual of operating procedures, finalized. This is basically a document meant to facilitate consistency among the investigators in the protocol, implementing and data collection across study sites. This step is important to reduce variability among the surgeons. Supposing you're going for a particular type of surgery that you're trying to, study. Reviewers examine the team's expertise, their commitment as demonstrated by the letter of support, and the available resources to complete the proposed research project. So this is how basically it goes. There is a pre-planning phase when all these, the research question is developed. You comb the literature, the systematic reviews, meta-analysis. You do a pilot study and apply for the clinical grant, planning grant. And in the planning phase again, you would have to establish your team, continue correspondence with the collaborating sites, develop manual operating procedures, so on. And finally, all this may take years before you really launch the multicentric trial, especially a huge one. So this is a bit about the pilot study and what it gives you is the interim sample size calculation and refine the statistical estimates of the parameters. So just a little bit on examples. A classical example of multicentric, randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled trial, the Bowman trial, where they have seen the use of maternal antifibrinolytic tranexamic acid for treatment of postpartum hemorrhage. And here the blinding was done. It was possible. They have used 1 gram of IV injection of tranexamic acid and a placebo used for the sodium chloride injection given as soon as possible. So it was a huge number that was involved with 193 hospitals and 21 centers. Countries, 21 countries. Now, this is another randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled trial. Here they have used 1,776 patients who were at risk of developing preterm pre-eclampsia to receive aspirin at a dose of 150 milligram or a placebo from 11 weeks to this. So here, a lot of work also goes into forming the placebo tablets. Somebody was given to manufacture this identical to aspirin tablets with respect to variables such as size, thickness, physical properties, and appearance. After randomization, the participants were prescribed the assigned. Of course, there was some criticism of use of placebo here, because these patients were high risk of developing PE, and we already know they benefit by getting aspirin, and half the controls were denied this and given 150, another half was not given. So just towards the end, I would briefly highlight the features of Waldel design RCT. The sample to be studied should be appropriate to the hypothesis that is being tested, so that any results are appropriately generalizable, and multi-center trials take care of that. A study should recruit sufficient patients to allow it to have high probability of detecting a clinically important difference between the treatments if a difference truly exists. Again, multi-center would take care of a good number of patients inducted to answer the question. There should be effective, that is concealed randomization of subjects to the intervention control group to eliminate selection bias and minimize confounding variables. So blinding and randomization take care of that. Both groups should be treated identically in all respect except for prevention being intervention that is being tested. And of course, here they're talking about the triple blind. This one where the investigator too is blinded. Then patients may be analyzed within the group to which they are allocated, irrespective of whether they experience the intended intervention. That is, the intention to treat analysis should be there. An analysis should be focusing on testing the research question that initially led to the trial. That is, according to the a priori hypothesis being tested, not something what they get all along. So with that, I thank you all for the patient hearing and also the opportunity to be here with this very academic group. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Meena, for nicely making us understand the placebo control and the randomized trial, how we need to plan up and how long it takes to do it. Can we have the wordings from Dr. Jaydeep Tangsa? Comments upon it?
No comments really. That was an excellent presentation. And I think these are all, unfortunately, not stressed upon enough in service training as well as in our undergraduate days. Biostatistics normally comes in PSM, and we tend to think of that as a little lighter kind of a subject. And really speaking, the way Dr. Meena Samant has explained, the way Dr. Samta Gupta has explained, I think it is very important that people hear this, understand it, and digest it, because that will give a good idea on how to interpret a trial. As important as the conclusion of the trial is, sometimes the headlines may really be misleading. And I think such webinars are extremely important to decipher the headlines. So thank you very much, Dr. Meena. Thank you, Dr. Samta, for those wonderful presentations. Thank you.
Thank you. Moving on ahead, we've got the next talk by Dr. Jaydeep Tang. And he is the past Secretary General of FOCSI, which is Federation of Ops Gyne Society of India. He's a project lead for FOCSI USAID project. 2020 to 2024, past president of Mumbai Ops Gyne Society. And we're going to learn today about luteal phase support, when, how much, and where. From Dr. Tang.
Should I start sharing my screen, Rakhi?
Yes, sir.
Right. I hope my slide is seen and I'm audible.
Yes, sir.
So first of all, let me congratulate Rakhi for putting this wonderfully academic program together. At first glance, it seems that it's very, for want of a better word, heavy. But the point is that we need these kind of programs, as I said, not only to understand the topic, but also to understand what leads to the conclusions of studies. And if we really don't understand that, sometimes we can be carried away by headlines, you know, breaking news, as we call it nowadays in the era of 24/7 television, and not really dig into why, you know, the conclusion has been reached, and also whether that conclusion is valid or not. I think both the things are important, because statistics can sometimes be subject to interpretation on what the study has been all about. So congratulations, Rakhi and Niharika and Kalyan, for putting this whole program together. Gratitude, of course, to Dr. Shanta Kumari, Dr. Madhuri Patel and Basab for encouraging such kind of programs. And I'm delighted to be a convener along with Rakhi, Niharika and Kalyan for this program, along with the coordinators, Charmila, Dr. Nagendra, Dr. Chandrika and Minu. I am also very happy to be a part of a session where Dr. Samta Gupta, Dr. Meena Samant and Dr. Lakshmi Shrikhande are going to be speaking and moderating, along with some wonderful panelists, Dr. Garima, Richard, Dr. Vidya, Anaita, Sita and Kiran Mai. So again, thank you, Rakhi. I think such programs are extremely important. And I do hope that at some point when the programs are coming to a conclusion, you will consider making a compendium of this program and perhaps publishing it either on our website or in hard copy, because I think this will be an invaluable resource, particularly for those who are in training and those who are in practice. So we are going to speak on luteal phase support, when and how much. But before I begin, let me request everyone who is present here to please support me as I stand for the presidency of FOCSE for this current election year, a request I will reiterate at the end of the presentation. So these are the talking points of my presentation. We'll talk about why the luteal phase is important. We'll talk a little bit about the physiology of the luteal phase, because obviously we last read about physiology in the first year of MBBS, and we are all quite advanced from then. We'll talk a little bit about the fallacies of luteal phase defect and why luteal phase defect as a clinical entity needs to be relooked quite systematically. And then we'll talk about progesterone and a little bit, just one or two slides about the role of estradiol in luteal phase defect. And I plan to do all this in the next 15 minutes, which I'm sure you'll agree is a fairly ambitious task. Rakhi, if I'm overshooting the time, please tell me, maybe 2 minutes before I need to finish. Let me first begin by talking a little bit about the importance of the luteal phase. You know, by the time the patient reaches the luteal phase, you have diagnosed her, you have recruited her, you've done her follicular studies and IUI plan relations, etc. And all that you want is for the patient to go back and then come back with a urine pregnancy test, which is positive, or a beta HCG, which is positive. And in all this, I'm afraid, we tend to take the luteal phase a little lightly. We don't really pay as much attention to it as we should. As Mark Twain said, it becomes something like a classic, something that everybody wants to have read and nobody actually wants to read. But the luteal phase is tremendously important, because if you really look at it, the goal of treatment, which is pregnancy, actually occurs in the luteal phase. And irrespective of what kind of cycle you do, agonist, antagonist, IUI, oral ovulation induction, the luteal phase actually remains constant. Okay, and because it remains constant, because the number of days of the luteal phase are actually more or less same as the follicular phase, we should ideally devote significantly more time to the luteal phase than we do. Just to give you an example, if you go to any conference on infertility, you will typically find that at least 40% of the sessions, or even 50% of the sessions, are given over to the follicular phase. Luteal phase is typically relegated to maybe one lecture, one keynote, or one session. And that's why I think we need to study the luteal phase a little better to understand it. It is a truism, and I think it is very well established, that whenever you perform an ovarian stimulation, you will affect both the luteal phase and the way ovulation occurs. I would just like to put forward this sort of a thinking point, if I may, as to why is the luteal phase altered so dramatically when you give a trigger? When you really think about it, your trigger, which is usually HCG, has two subunits. There's an alpha subunit and then there's a beta subunit. It is the alpha subunit of HCG, which is biochemically similar to LH, which essentially fools the oocyte into thinking that the LH surge has taken place, which works as the trigger. The problem is that when you administer a dose of HCG, you are giving a fixed amount of that biomimic LH. And because you're administering a fixed amount, which is not titrated to the estrogen dose or the number of follicles, it is quite possible and in all likelihood, a singular possibility that the shift within the oocyte, which should occur from granulosa and estrogen to theca and progesterone, is incomplete. And because this remains incomplete, it produces what I like to call the iatrogenic luteal phase defect. Luteal phase defect, I think, is something which has always been quite controversial. But it is quite clear that whenever you use a trigger, there will be some modification, or I may go so far as to use the word problem, with the luteal phase, because the shift of metabolism that should occur, as I said, from granulosa and estrogen to theca and progesterone within the cells of the ovary is incomplete. And because it's incomplete, you're essentially producing a luteal phase defect. Luteal phase defects per se have always been problematic. It is my view, and it has been for several years now, that we perhaps should not pay as much attention to the luteal phase defect as a clinical entity vis-a-vis the luteal phase itself. This is because, first of all, no uniform definition of a luteal phase defect has been agreed upon. And secondly, because of the way we diagnose luteal phase defect, we typically make the diagnosis post facto. Post facto means, for example, you can make a diagnosis of luteal phase defect either by doing a progesterone determination on day 21 or by an endometrial biopsy. In both instances, by the time you receive the results, it is already too late to do anything about it. Moreover, if you accept the fact that in every cycle, there are different levels of estrogen, different oocytes, different endometrium, because the endometrium has been shared last time, how can you extrapolate the results of one cycle to the other cycle, given the fact that you are expecting completely different hormone profiles in each cycle? And that is why I would say that this ASRM opinion actually says it the best when it says current clinical irrelevance of luteal phase deficiency. So don't bother to try and make a diagnosis of the luteal phase defect, because the fact of the matter is that everybody uses progesterone anyway. First of all, no definition. Second of all, post facto diagnosis. And third of all, extrapolation of the diagnosis from one cycle to another. And therefore, you would have to say that although the biomolecular concepts of luteal phase are fascinating and do offer great promises, most of the factors cannot adequately be evaluated, rendering the development of therapeutic remedies impractical. So what does that leave us with? That essentially leaves us with providing luteal support in practically all cycles where you either perform a stimulation and have more than a monofollicular response, or any cycle where you use a trigger. Because that amounts to a large number of cycles, we need to look at our options for luteal support very carefully. Quite clearly, HCG, which is probably the single most important reason to have OHSS, and in fact is no better than progesterone in terms of pregnancy rates, should not be used as a luteal support at all. Blanket statement. It should also not be used, because if you use HCG, you will not know whether your results are because of your administration of HCG or whether the patient is pregnant. You are therefore left with progesterone, which is available either as oral, IM, or vaginal form, and we will look at each of these in turn. The first thing I want to say, and probably a very important thing, is that if you're using natural micronized progesterone, please don't use it orally. Using natural micronized progesterone has resulted in the absence of any secretory transformation of the endometrium. So natural micronized progesterone, unless it's available in some kind of a special form, should not be used orally for luteal phase support. If you want to use an oral formulation, then what you are left with essentially is dihydrogestrone. And because you are left with dihydrogestrone, dihydrogestrone seems to be attractive from using it orally kind of a perspective because of the way it is biometabolized in the body and becomes available. One of the issues with dihydrogestrone so far really has been the fact that the studies which surround dihydrogestrone, starting from the Chakravarti study, the Whitehead study, right down to the last one from Fatemi, which is reported here in 2008, have either been too small or have not really been very robust. So if you look at dihydrogestrone in literature so far, and you will look at all the studies I have enumerated there, the essential conclusion was that it's an extremely promising drug. However, it does need more work on it. Meanwhile, what happened was that there was the scare of congenital anomalies with dihydrogestrone. I have to say that this is where going beyond the headlines help. If you really look at these studies very carefully, you look at the settings in which the study was done, you will realize that the conclusions which were drawn from these studies were really not very good. And therefore, we are now quite clear that dihydrogestrone does not cause congenital anomalies. So, till 2016, we had all these studies and we had all these limitations in literature. And then the LOTUS-1 trial came about. What the LOTUS-1 trial did was compared 10 milligram dihydrogestrone given TDS with intravaginal capsules of micronized vaginal progesterone. And when they compared these two groups in fresh IVF cycles, it was quite clearly seen that oral dihydrogestrone demonstrated non-inferiority to micronized vaginal progesterone in the form of capsules. The LOTUS-2 trial looked at a comparison of dihydrogestrone vis-a-vis micronized vaginal progesterone gel. And again, this study demonstrated non-inferiority. A word about non-inferiority. Sometimes, because that word inferior is there in a non-inferiority trial, it is actually taken to be a disadvantage. But the fact of the matter is that, again, if you go beyond the headlines and you look at the confidence intervals and the odds ratios, which you will see here for dihydrogestrone, you will see that the data could actually suggest some kind of a superiority for dihydrogestrone, even without it being a trial which is designed for superiority. A word again, since we are talking about studies in detail, typically superiority trials would nowadays be done when you're comparing no intervention versus an intervention. Non-inferiority trials are also a little better to do because the requirement of sample size is limited compared to a superiority trial. So here you have it, LOTUS-1, LOTUS-2 showing that at least in fresh IVF cycles, dihydrogestrone is non-inferior in these circumstances. The other route of administration that we had was IM progesterone. And of course, this was the age-old route of using progesterone. Quite frankly, I have stopped using this since almost 2002. When I started IVF, I was also using IM progesterone. There is some data to suggest that some patients could be benefited, but it's very few and far between. I would go so far to the extent of saying, all of us have these patients who keep on coming back to us despite not getting pregnant. Give them a couple of injections of IM progesterone. You can rest assured they will move to the neighboring infertility specialist. Of course, we now have intramuscular or subcutaneous progesterone, which is available, which is supposed to be less painful. Of course, the gold standard really of progesterone till now before all this data on dihydrogesterone came about was vaginal progesterone. And the reason why it was the gold standard was that it seemed that when you give progesterone vaginally, the amount of progesterone that was available locally in the site where it was needed, which is the uterus, seemed to actually be maximum. So these are all the ways in which vaginal progesterone was available, starting from micronized tablets to gel to effervescent tablets. My personal preference has always been for the gel or the capsules. Now, if you look at serum concentrations for IM versus vaginal progesterone, IM progesterone will always have a higher serum concentration. However, again, you can see the studies over here which seem to suggest that a higher serum concentration does not translate into a higher bioavailability. And that is why we say that we need to go beyond the headlines while looking at all this kind of data. So what is the best timing of starting luteal support? For IVF, it is very clear. You do the pickup and you start luteal support. Now, if you extrapolate the same thing to oral ovulation induction or to IUI cycles, the analogous time scale for this would be somewhere between 36 to 48 hours after giving the trigger. And you need to start it at that time and not before you give the trigger and not too late after giving the trigger. Otherwise, your pregnancy rates will get compromised. Estradiol for luteal phase support is something that we routinely use, of course, for recipient cycles in IVF, but is not currently recommended as a matter of routine for all other kinds of cycles. There is data for, there is data against. Until now, the use of estradiol is perhaps limited to personal preference. So if you're doing an IVF cycle, you start the progesterone off immediately after the pickup. If you're doing an IUI or an oral ovulation induction cycle, you'd start the progesterone within 36 to 48 hours after giving the trigger. Quite clearly, all the data which is there suggests that using progesterone, particularly when you've used a trigger and particularly when you have more than a monofollicular response, is certainly useful in increasing your pregnancy rates. Big question of when to stop luteal support. Data suggests that you could stop it quite early, within 30 days of embryo transfer, or stop it when the fetal heart activity is seen. But you know, in practice, most of the times we tend to continue luteal support till the 12th week of gestation. So to summarize, you should use luteal support whenever gonadotropins and or a trigger with multiple follicular recruitment and ovulation is used. IM and vaginal progesterone are equivalent, but IM should not be the first choice. As of now, it seems that dihydrogesterone is at least as effective as vaginal progesterone. And if you read between the lines, maybe has got an edge in terms of superiority, and the duration of luteal support required may be shorter than current practice. So let me end with this slide, which talks about the use of the drug or the procedure versus time. And when something new comes in, you know, particularly in infertility, we all get very excited. And we say, oh, it's fantastic. You know, let's use it for everybody because we want to improve our pregnancy rates. Over a period of time, we realize that perhaps it's not all that it's cracked up to be. And therefore, you know, we get disappointed in it because, yeah, pregnancy rate 100% to hua hi nahi. And then we get disappointed. We say, oh, it's rotten. I wouldn't even give it to my dog. But slowly over a period of time, we come to realize that like everything else in medicine, it has its own place, depending on the patient and the indication. So thank you very much, Rakhi and team, for inviting me for this presentation. And let me please reiterate my request for support as I stand for the presidency of FOXI. I have a website. It's called isupportjaideeptang.com. If you're watching this on your laptop and you turn on your phone and you scan those QR codes, it will take you to my website, or it will take you to the Telegram group where I put up all the webinars that I speak in. I'm very happy to say that more than 3,000 Foxians have already registered their support for me on the website, and I'm deeply appreciative and grateful to each one of them. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Tang. And as always, your talks are mesmerizing and to the point, and there's always a learning curve. The more difficult the subject you make, the more simple out of it, and to make all of us understand that it's just a cakewalk. You don't have to bother that much for anything and everything. It is Dr. Tang's magic.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Best wishes for your election, sir.
Thank you.
Moving on ahead, we've got a much awaited panel for us on recurrent pregnancy loss. For that, I could not think of anybody else other than Dr. Lakshmi Shrikhande, who is the chairperson elect of ICOG, the Indian College of Obs and Gyne, the academic wing of FOCSI. And she has been the corresponding editor and journal of Obs Gyne Society of India, that is JOGI. National Corresponding Secretary Association of Medical Wing of India, founder, patron, and president of ISOPAM Vidarbha chapter 2019-21. And here I present to you Dr. Lakshmi Shrikhande. The dice is yours, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much, Rakhi. And really, you have started something out of the box series. And I wish you all the very best for this EndoLit series. And today, I am going to moderate panel discussion on
recurrent. Can we have the CVs of the panelists, please?
Yeah. Monica? And the choice of panelists by Rakhi has made my job very easy. So first, we have our expert esteemed panelist, Dr. Garima Kachwaha, who is additional professor at AIIMS, New Delhi. And she was joint secretary of FOCSI in 2016-17. Next panelist is Dr. Sita Ramamurthy Pal. She is consultant, fetal medicine and obstetrics at Apollo Hospital, Kolkata. And she is joint clinical secretary of Bengal OBGY Society. Dr. Vidya Thobi is professor and unit head at Vijayapur, Karnataka. And she was chairperson of Food, Drugs and Medico-Surgical Equipment Committee, FOCSI, from 2018-20. Dr. Kiran Mai, she is associate professor at Osmania Medical College, Hyderabad, and she is national convener for the workshops in this current year. Anahita is honorary consultant at SAFI and St. Elizabeth Hospital, and she was former professor and unit head, St. GS Medical College and KM Hospital, Mumbai. Dr. Richa Singh is professor in Department of OBGY, SN Medical College, Agra, and she has received Best Teachers Award. She received Best Teacher Award by students of her college. Welcome, Dr. Richa. So now I will share my screen, and it's a pleasure to welcome all the esteemed panelists, friends. You all will agree with me that recurrent pregnancy loss is really a frustrating condition for both the doctors as well as the patient. And it is a very, very traumatic condition for the woman who is suffering from recurrent pregnancy loss. And when patient comes to us, they come with only two queries. That is, doctor, what was the cause why I lost this baby? And whether I am going to lose my another pregnancy as well. So she is worried only about the cause and recurrence. But as you all will agree that whatever we do, we can find the cause only in 50% of cases. So here I am going to take through case discussion one by one the important causes of recurrent pregnancy loss, and our panelists, they will be giving you a crisp to the point answer for your questions. So first I am starting with Garima. I will share my screen. Yeah, my screen is visible. Garima, this is for you. A 27-year-old woman comes to you with, this is going, she has come to you with a history of two spontaneous abortions at 8 to 10 weeks of gestation. And when you did ultrasound, you found out that either it can be a septate uterus or it can be a biconduit uterus. So how you will proceed?
Okay, ma'am. Good evening, ma'am. So she's a 27-year-old woman. Had two abortions.
Your voice is breaking. Your voice is breaking.
Now can you hear me?
Yeah. Now it's clear.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes. Yes, Garima.
So, first and foremost, I'd like to confirm whether it is a septate or a biconduit uterus, because
So you will be planning
management of both these conditions.
So how you would like to confirm?
I will be planning to do a 3D ultrasound.
Okay. Yes.
Gold standard may be, I will be doing 3D ultrasound, and because it is invasive and it is a very good modality to differentiate between the two, and I can confirm my diagnosis, so counsel patient accordingly and plan further.
Excellent. And I think now 3D is available at many places, and 3D has confirmed that it's a case of septum. So now how we will proceed with the treatment? You will plan hysteroscopy, but whether you would like to combine this hysteroscopy with laparoscopy, or you will do standalone hysteroscopy? Garima? Kaki, have you lost Garima?
I think we've lost Dr. Garima. She'll be rejoining probably.
No, okay. I can see her.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah. Hello? Garima, you are with me?
Yeah. So yeah. Then once the diagnosis of septate uterus is confirmed, then I will be planning after counseling for the septal resection, hysteroscopic septal resection. Now, as far as whether I'll be combining laparoscopy or not, because usually when there is an expert person who has done lot of cases and experiences there, then there is no need to add laparoscopy. But in cases where either your experience is not enough or your diagnosis is not enough, that is very important. If you are not confident of your diagnosis or you don't have facility for a 3D or 4D ultrasound, then the gold standard even today for the diagnosis of Müllerian anomalies is laparoscopy. Great. Another advantage of using a laparoscopy is that you can also sometimes come across certain ovarian pathologies, or if you want to see for any other, pelvic or tubal or uterine factors. So the advantage of laparoscopy is there, but if you're sure of your diagnosis, then you can go without laparoscopy also.
Yes, Garima, very crystal clear take-home message you have given to the audience. What about her post-op management, when she can conceive again?
Yeah, since hysteroscopic septal resection is all a very minimally invasive procedure, and as soon as the procedure is done, the regeneration of the endometrium starts taking place. So our policy is that she can conceive within the next 2 to 3 months. So if she is having 2 normal periods after that, that is enough for us, and we can counsel her to start planning for pregnancy.
Yeah, in short, I would like you to tell about the other uterine factors which really contribute to RPL to our participants.
So the most common and the most important, we have already discussed the septum. Other is that unicornuate uterus or bicornuate bicornuate uterus usually don't require treatment and is not a direct cause for RPL. But if there is a unicornuate uterus, the initial conceptions may be abortion, and then progressively increased gestation may occur. Apart from these, the other uterine factors most important, most commonly associated with RPL are either an endometrial polyp or a submucous myoma.
And if the opinion about T-shaped uterus?
Yeah, T-shaped uterus. The first is that it is very difficult even to conceive in a T-shaped uterus. So they usually present with infertility. But if the patient is presenting with the recurrent abortion, then there is a partial or a unilaterally T-shaped uterus. And in that case, you can plan for lateral septoplasty.
Yes. Thank you, Garima, for your crisp messages. Now let's go to Dr. Kiranmayi. Kiranmayi, you are with me? Yeah, she is a 32-year-old woman. She has come to you with spontaneous painless abortions at 16 to 18 weeks. Kiranmayi?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So now how we will proceed? We have covered the first trimester abortions because of anatomical factors. And now this is the second trimester loss.
So this is one abortion or more than one abortion that I would like to...
Two abortions. I forgot to write.
So definitely a history of painless mid-trimester abortions, very significant, because just with this history, we can have a history indicated encirclage, but we have to rule out other causes, evaluate her and counsel her, and all that preliminary things have to be done. These are two abortions. So definitely the history indicated encerclage is one option. Then the other option is to go for a serial ultrasound measurement of the cervical length, starting from around maybe 14 weeks and all. Then if the cervix length is less than, is going to below 25 mm, then definitely we can go for, I would go for a cerclage. Or the other option is also, if the cervical length is not short in this pregnancy, if it is more than 25 mm, we can also go for a progesterone therapy. So this is two options that we have.
Yeah, can I interrupt you, Kiran Mai? If she has come to you in the preconception period and you find that cervical length is 3 centimeter, so what are the options for this patient? She has lost two babies because of cervical incompetence, but cervix is not short. So how you will counsel her?
Because this is happening in the mid-trimester, and if we rule out other causes, definitely we have to evaluate and do a workup of, you know, not missing other causes.
So
and
that is what? What are the other causes of cervical incompetence? I mean, which you would like tell, would you like tell to participant that they should ask in history taking?
Yeah, yeah. The history should include any, you know, procedures on the cervix, any DNC, any trachelectomies or any procedure on the cervix or associated uterine anomalies, then all these procedures and all this history has to be taken definitely, which, the important causes of cervical incompetence. We have to counsel her. Then we have to go for first trimester, the routine screening and then the biochemical and also the early TFA. And then we have to go for the, routine second trimester TFA also. But we have to prepare her psychologically that she might need a encerclage. And but
would you like to put a prophylactic cerclage for her, or will you monitor her throughout the first trimester and then take a call?
If it is two abortions, as is the case in this scenario, then I would like to go for a prophylactic encerclage, which is history indicated. That is, we can go a little early before 16 weeks, at around 14 to 16 weeks.
Now, since we are here and you said something about the progesterone, so how progesterone will help this patient?
There are definitely many studies, ma'am, RCOG guidelines, and then all the guidelines have very clearly mentioned that in a case, especially with such history of previous mid-trimester abortions, when the cervix length is not short, then we can definitely offer her a vaginal progesterone.
And you would like
and
to
if
start?
There is,
what week of gestation you would like to start?
We can start it early, madam. We can start it early and continue till 36 weeks.
So Dr. Kiran Mai has given very crystal clear take-home messages on how to manage a case of cervical incompetence. Now let us go to Dr. Richa. Richa, she is 24-year-old obese woman. She is a known case of PCOS since menarche, and she comes to you with history of two spontaneous first trimester losses. So there are two specific questions for you. Can PCOS contribute to recurrent pregnancy loss, and how you will counsel this patient and manage her?
Well, the first part is that definitely PCOS contributes to recurrent pregnancy loss. And there are many factors. The main factor, obesity, which is indirectly linked to hyperandrogenemia and insulin resistance. But again, some say that obesity is a confounding factor with PCOS. But definitely in obese patients, we found a high degree of insulin resistance and hyperandrogenemia. And they influence by changing the endometrial receptivity. The receptors in the endometrium, because of hyperandrogenemia, they contribute to the recurrent pregnancy losses. The high LH level again indirectly contributes to increase in androgen levels. So all these factors work together, and because of which a patient of PCOS is more exposed to recurrent pregnancy losses. And counseling will include that the drugs, no drug in particular has been approved for management of recurrent abortions in PCOS because of insulin resistance or because of obesity. Metformin has been used in many trials. So what we have here, mainly we have to stress is counseling so that she is able to reduce her weight and come back to a normal BMI before she tries to conceive again. So counseling has a...
Very true. Even the recent guideline released in 2018 gives a lot of emphasis on lifestyle modification. So yes, you will advise lifestyle modification and metformin when you would like to start and in what dose? Richa? Richa, are you with me? Rakhi, have you lost her?
I don't know. She's there, but probably she's not there.
Okay, I will continue when she joins. I will move to Vidya because this is a very, very interesting aspect of recurrent pregnancy loss, which we routinely don't talk about. We always focus on genetic and anatomical and the endocrine factors. So Vidya, this is the question for you. She is 28-year-old, obese, smoker and coffee addict. She comes to you with repeated first trimester losses, two or three, because she doesn't remember one was chemical or biochemical, whatever. So I want to know from you, does personal habits can also cause recurrent pregnancy loss? And what is the role of nutrition in these cases?
Thank you, Lakshmi. This is very, very important sort of the topic and very, very important question you have asked. And it is very difficult for me to answer. One thing is there is always an impact of the many lifestyle factors whenever we are talking on the risk of recurrent pregnancy loss. Now, this patient, she's a smoker. She is also obese and she also drinks a lot of coffee. So we all know that these are the various risk factors for recurrent pregnancy loss. And when we talk of obesity, obesity is another risk factor. And we talk when there is a BMI more than 30, it has been evaluated as a one of the risk factors. There are various mechanisms how this obesity causes miscarriage. One is there is an adverse impact on the endometrial development or there is also the oocyte quality is affected. We know the this one effect of obesity and PCOS on various systems as well. Then another is there are again the production of pro-inflammatory and pro-thrombotic agents whenever there is a lot of adipose tissue. So this is a main factor that whenever there is an elevated BMI, it is always associated with pregnancy loss. And we know about the anovulation, other potential side effects of obesity. And when there was a meta-analysis, I just want to quote here, then whenever there was a body mass index more than 25, which was associated with almost more than 50% of increased odd of ratio of pregnancy loss. So obesity is one factor. And second one is a smoking. Smoking, we all know that it contains plenty of toxic components like nicotine. Nicotine is a main compound of cigarette smoking, and it has got a vasoconstriction constrictor effect, which also reduces the uterine and placental blood flow. So this is very important. And I just want to point out is even though you are not a smoker, you can be a passive smoker.
Yes, very good.
So this passive smoker, many times we are exposed to various chemical exposure of this passive smoking, and which again causes many changes in our body.
So if husband is smoker, I think we all have to ask the history whether your husband smokes. Because she is a passive smoker if husband is smoking.
She is a passive smoker. And about the coffee, coffee is another factor here in this patient. She is how much coffee she drinks, I don't know. But if she is a moderate coffee drinker and...
No, that is what I am coming to you. Vidya, I am interrupting. Whenever we ask any question on nutrition, everyone says drink in moderation. So what you advise, so, what is moderation
when it comes to smoking,
drinking and coffee?
How many cigarettes smoking, how many cigarettes per day? This is very important.
So she is asking you, hey, doctor, I can't take a cigarette per day.
So not more than 3 cups of coffee, and that coffee, which type of coffee also, more than 300 milligrams per day, she should not take the coffee. And this, as we all know, that recurrent pregnancy loss is a multifactorial polygenetic disease. And they have observed that this coffee, caffeine, which is a content, it is because of some enzyme, that is CYP1A2, some enzyme, which is primarily responsible for this caffeine metabolism. So some people who are deficient in this enzyme, they are affected most. So we don't go into these details, but I just went into the details why this coffee is culprit.
Yes.
So that is in some of the genes also are responsible for this caffeine metabolism. Alcohol, we all know that we know about this fetal alcohol syndrome.
What is moderation? Dr. Vidya, she is asking you.
Again, moderation, but we should not ask. And the paternal, we always forget to take history of father. And this paternal alcohol consumption of more than 5 drinks a week has also been shown to be associated with the reduction in sperm count and the reproductive potential. So always we take history of a woman, but not the man. So that is also important here about the alcohol consumption. Then you were asking me about the adequate nutrients and micronutrient supplements.
Yes,
they are very important for both male and female, like in men about the sperm morphology, motility, in women about the oocyte quality, then various implantation, all those things are very important. And these antioxidants are thoroughly studied. They are very vital to reduce oxidative stress. And this oxidative stress is about the reactive oxygen species and all those details I don't want to go. So commonly studied are the vitamin D supplementation, then vitamin E, vitamin C, beta carotene, coenzyme Q10. These are the micronutrients, and iron, folic acid. These all play a beneficial role in all this recurrent pregnancy loss.
Yeah.
Vitamin B6, yeah. B12, yeah. And iron. If you want to tell me to tell the dosage, I will not go into the details.
No, I will not. I just want to interrupt you and ask you quickly how tea can also affect RPL, because many of the husbands, they complain to us that, madam, she's a tea addict, she drinks 10 to 14 cups of green, tea, and green scores, they do drink 10 to 15 cups of tea.
Even tea also contains tannin. Tannin, that is also not good for health. And we always talk of green tea. And this green tea is again an antioxidant. So if she drinks green tea, no objection. But regular tea also contains tannin. That is the main thing.
So I'm so happy, Vidya, you have really given message on about the tea, coffee, smoking, drinking, obesity, and the role of balanced diet. So now let us go to Dr. Anahita. Anahita, she's 32 year old, comes with a history of severe PIH in first pregnancy. It had to be terminated because of this severe PIH at 27 weeks of gestation. Next two pregnancies she lost in first trimester. Now she has come to you with a report of positive lupus anticoagulant and your plan of action for her. So Anahita?
Yeah.
Are you with me?
I'm very much with you.
Yeah. Anahita, was it justified to do the EPLA test? In short, I wish you to tell the participants about the criteria when you should do this test.
So first of all, severe preeclampsia in the first pregnancy could be because of so many other factors. But the fact that subsequent to that, she has lost two pregnancies in the first trimester, I think there is no point in waiting for one more loss prior to investigating. So I do feel that it was justified to do the EPLA test in this patient. We also have to keep in mind that though the traditional definition said 3 or more spontaneous abortions, in clinical practice today, with the latest ACOG guidelines, even 2 pregnancy losses will warrant investigation. That's the first point. So yes, it was justified to do the EPLA test. To go to your next question, what is the reason or what are the pitfalls in the diagnosis? I think the the one message I would like to communicate here is that please do not do a test if you cannot interpret it correctly yes. and take action
yes.
on that test.
Yes, the best message you have given.
Thank you. So if we look at the criteria for diagnosing a patient with primary antiphospholipid syndrome, that is purely obstetric, then we have to look at both the laboratory criteria as well as the clinical criteria. And in the clinical criteria, it will be if she has either had a thrombotic event or if she has had a previous pregnancy loss of a viable fetus, especially with preeclampsia like this patient, or she has had the loss of a morphologically normal fetus before 10 weeks and after 12, the definitions are very clear, as well as one laboratory and one clinical criteria. So in the clinical criteria, it is that she must have either a lupus anticoagulant, two reports 12 weeks apart, or along with anticardiolipin antibody IgG, IgM, again, two values 12 weeks apart, as well as more specific now is the beta 2 glycoprotein antibodies. So my suggestion is that if you are actually going to consider that your patient is a case of APLA, you must do all the values and then start the treatment. Now in this case, she has come to me, I can't make out whether she has come to me in the inter-pregnancy interval.
Inter-pregnancy, yes.
So if she has come in the inter-pregnancy interval, I would definitely have enough time to repeat the tests 12 weeks apart.
Good.
After which I would then counsel her to undertake a pregnancy because she obviously has no difficulty in conceiving. So when she's about to undertake the pregnancy, I would obviously start folic acid, multinutrients, tell her to stop smoking, drinking, coffee, lose weight, all the other factors that we have seen in the previous cases.
Anaita, will you start aspirin also?
Typically, I would not start aspirin unless her pregnancy test comes positive.
Positive, okay. And are there any conditions where you can get false positive report?
So basically, if you look at the type of tests that are done for antiphospholipid, if you're looking at only the APTT and if she's on other medications, etc., you could get a false positive. So the laboratory is also extremely important and the type of test should be mentioned, whether it is dilute Russell Viper venom or kaolin, etc. But if she is on other medications, for example, she is on aspirin for some other reason, then of course the test is going to give a little false positive.
So like we have rightly said, when you are doing tests, you should know the pitfalls, you should know how to interpret it and how this test report is going to help you in managing your patient. Excellent.
I want to add one more point here, Lakshmi, that yes. If the patient has got a thrombotic event in yes. her past history or in the previous pregnancies, which has been documented, then apart from doing the antiphospholipid screen, there is a value to doing the thrombophilia screen.
Profile.
And again, here I want to say that do not randomly, arbitrarily do the full thrombophilia screen only when you want to rule out an antiphospholipid because it's an extremely expensive panel of tests. Yes. Yeah.
And once she becomes pregnant, how you will manage, Anahita? She gets you in the pregnancy period, but now she is in first trimester.
So first of all, I would emphasize to this patient that she should follow up with me very rigorously. As soon as the beta HCG is positive, typically we should begin aspirin and only till...
What dose?
I'm coming to that. I wanted a comment. I wanted to say something about that. Okay. But as soon as I see a intrauterine gestation sac, I would definitely add aspirin as well. I mean, heparin as well. Now, here the point is that there are enough studies to show that aspirin alone is not going to sustain this pregnancy. Steroids don't really have a role, but the best combination is aspirin plus heparin. Again, recent literature suggests that lower doses of aspirin are useless. So you should ideally go for 150 milligrams of aspirin, ideally as a single dose taken at bedtime. I'm happy that you like my answer. But unfortunately, a lot of OBGYs...
Because everyone starts 75 milligrams of PIH ka adat hai.
Yes. So here the recent literature shows very clearly that if you want to have any clinical impact in the reduction of preeclampsia, IUGR, oligohydramnios, etc., 150 is the dose to go with. Of course, Western literature has had trials of 81 milligrams and so on, which we don't have available to us. So you are better off giving 150 single dose at bedtime. Coming to heparin, of course, you would like to begin with the low molecular weight heparin. And if she has no history of a thrombotic event in the past, then you would start with just a prophylactic dose. And then you would continue this ideally till 34 or 36 weeks. And then you may stop it. Suppose there is a history of a thrombotic event in the past, then you would go with the full therapeutic dose. And this should be continued for 6 weeks postpartum.
Can you just elaborate by the therapeutic dose and your prophylactic dose?
So basically, depending also on the weight of the patient, but typically the prophylactic dose we would begin would be about 40 milligrams of enoxaparin. And the therapeutic dose could either be 40 milligrams twice a day or at least 60 milligrams daily.
Do they need monitoring if you are starting low molecular weight heparin?
So again, the Western literature talks a lot about heparin-induced osteopenia, etc. But typically what we do is we would do an initial CBC and then maybe every month or 2 months, we would just repeat the counts. But typically we haven't seen any real problems. We don't have factor 10A monitoring available to us so easily. Otherwise, that is the recommended test that you can do if patients are on low molecular weight heparin. Of course, we are anyway giving our pregnant women calcium and vitamin D. So I think osteopenia, we have not really seen or documented any such cases.
Yeah, and we tell them to have the calcium-rich diet as well.
Yes.
So yes, Anahita, I'm really happy you have given practical take-home messages to our participants as far as APLA goes. Thank you. Let us come to Dr. Sita. Sita, she is 24-year-old, husband is 26-year. It's a consanguineous marriage. She has come to you with history of 4 consecutive missed abortions at 8 to 10 weeks. And now she is 6 weeks pregnant. And she is very much worried, anxious, you can understand. And she, her first question is whether I will carry this pregnancy to the term. So how you are going to counsel her?
Thank you. Thank you, madam, for that question. And I would like to thank Rakhi, congratulate her, and thank you for giving me this opportunity here. So as you rightly said in the beginning, the first question the patient, the couple wants to know is what is the cause and what is the recurrence rate. Now this lady sadly has already lost 4 pregnancies at 8 to 10 weeks. So of course it is important, as we've heard earlier, as to whether the heartbeat was there, you know, the fetal heart was present before she lost, or whether it was just an anembryonic pregnancy, whatever it is.
It was missed abortion. Absent heartbeat.
So it was, we would, and I assume we would have done the other investigations because that is important. But the most, the two important causes for anyone to tell the recurrence is the history of number of previous losses and the age of the patient. So these two are the main determinants in how you counsel the patient. Now this lady has already had 4 consecutive missed, miscarriages, but luckily for her, she's 26-year-old. So there is a tabular, you know, there is a table that sort of it says with number of miscarriages and the age. So obviously with age, as the woman loses more pregnancies, her aneuploidy risk also increases. So the chance of, you know, having a miscarriage also increases. But if her age is less, like here, she's less than 30, even with 3 or 4 miscarriages, she would have a, you know, the chance of a live pregnancy rate would be around 75% to 80%. So there is a table available, you know, in the ESHRAE guidelines itself. It says what is the prognosis, how you can prognosticate these women and counsel them that despite this, all this, because of your age, there could be factors and we need to investigate, but this is what your prognosis would be for the next pregnancy.
Sita, for the patient as well as for the clinicians who are listening to you, that clinician should not become frustrated.
Absolutely.
As you rightly said, even after 4 abortions, she has almost 70% chance of carrying this baby.
This, because of her age, madam. Because if she was 35 or 40, that would obviously change the figure. So but it is important to note that after this, what were you asking? Yeah.
But unfortunately, she's
already lost.
Has fallen into 30% category and she has come to you with absent fetal heart at 9 weeks of gestation.
Absolutely. So now I don't know if there are any investigations was done beforehand, but now we really need to investigate what was the cause. And considering that they are a consanguineous couple, that which you have to keep in mind, that the risk of a genetic condition causing a problem in the embryo is quite likely. Now, the very important thing that we need to realize this earlier, people used to historically just do a karyotype of the products of conception, and they used to not get any answers because it was important to know that then the karyotype routinely looks as you look at the cells and you arrest the cells in metaphase, and then you look at the cells, and there was a lot of problem with culture failure. So you never got any actual results. But over the years, as genetics has advanced and with the other genetic tests coming into being, some of the studies which were done on pre-implantation diagnosis for IVF couples, they found that out of the 50% which we say unexplained, more than 50% could be explained by genetic causes if we did the right tests. And that is why when the Royal College initially said in 2011 that you should not be doing any genetic tests, only in the clinical research setting. Yeah, I'll come in.
Product of conception. So now, don't tell participants how to collect the sample and set the sample, because that is a basic practical problem.
So now the ESHRE recommends that if you do this test, it gives an explainable cause to the couple and they can understand, they can take it better. What treatment can be offered will depend upon what you find. But at least if you offer the right test, it is important. So now the recommendation is that you can do a analysis on the products of conception. You should not restrict to a routine karyotype. I mean, you should not just collect the sample and send it for a histology saying it's products of conception. That's not going to give you any answer. You should not send it for a routine karyotyping because there is a lot of failure rate. There is a lot of maternal cell contamination because they cannot separate the cells from the normal blood and everything. So the right test to do is a chromosomal microarray, or CGH as we call it, where it looks at the cells in more resolution. The culture failure rate is much less, and you can look at unbalanced translocations which can occur in this embryo, which can be a major cause of the recurrent pregnancy loss, which means that if the father and mother are carrying a balanced translocation or an inversions or any sort of duplications, which may not cause a phenotypically abnormal picture. In the sense, the mother and father will be normal, but when they conceive, the fetus will have an embryo, the embryo may have an unbalanced translocation, and that can cause the problems. So the recommendation is now that you collect the, coming to how you collect the sample, is never put, when you're suspecting or whenever you're trying to do a genetic analysis, never put the sample in formalin. That is the worst thing you can do, because that will not give you any answers. It is just going to go to waste. Put in a saline, normal saline, or some of the labs have a media where you can collect it. When you're planning an evacuation for these women, you plan, inform the couple that this is what you're going to do, and you collect the sample and you send it. So when you look at these problems, when you look at the chromosomal microarray, it will give you a better picture as to what is the cause. And depending on that, so now the recent recommendations is you do the PCO, the product of conceptions, you analyze it by CGH, that is, or chromosomal microarray, which is the same. And then if you get an unbalanced translocation, you go back retrospectively to assess the parents for a parental karyotyping to look for any balanced translocations. And if they have that problem, then you send the couple for a genetic counseling. So this is the recent advances or recent recommendations that's come up. And then if the parents are found to have a problem, then they go for genetic counseling as to what are the options available. If it is so that they can have a pre-implantation genetic diagnosis or a pre-implantation genetic screening where they look at an embryo biopsy or polar biopsy, those sort of things where the euploid gamete or embryo can be transferred doing an IVF. So this is the recent recommendation.
This is the fifth loss, and she's really frustrated. She's asking you what are her other options. So will you advise her about the option of replacing one gamete?
Absolutely, that is the other option.
And which gamete, she is asking you.
So it all, again, I would strongly recommend this lady to have a genetic counseling, and depending on her age, if we can go for the male testing if necessary, and if you find anything abnormal in any of the two, then accordingly that gamete can be replaced. But more importantly, more commonly, it is the ovum egg, that is egg donation, that is usually advised.
Fantastic, Sita, because you have given very clear-cut message to our participants that POC should not be sent for routine karyotyping because it is not going to give you any answer. And if you are planning to send product of conceptions for genetic studies, of course, you have to counsel the patient. you have to tell them the cost, because they are costly. Absolutely. Investigations.
Yeah. Yeah.
You have to have tie up with that lab and tell them to send whatever the container or with media, Sita was telling. And in case it is not there, collect the sample in normal saline and hand over to them as soon as possible. So
a lot of cases they also do is initially they do the karyotyping just for to get any major triploidies or anything which could be missed. And if that is normal, if you get an answer there, it's fine. But if that is normal, you store the DNA, and then later on the couple can again go in for a chromosomal microarray, which we do for our fetal samples as well, because if they don't want to spend everything at one point, you send one sample, you do one test, and if that is normal and you're looking for more answers, then you have to go in for the other testing.
But this is also the best option for counseling the couple, because the cost factor matters a lot.
Yeah,
because as such, if you are planning to send POC, you are doing surgical abortion.
Going
for medical abortion.
Yeah.
So the cost of surgical abortion plus the cost of genetic studies matters. It's
going to be quite a lot for them.
Yes, it becomes quite a lot. So thank you, Sita, for your fantastic take-home messages. Vidya, just your quick answer on this question. Because routinely we are asked,
Richa also along.
Richa, I will. Vidya, just quickly, because most of the time our residents, our anesthetists who are working in OT, they have a lot of exposure to the general anesthesia. And this anesthetist, she has one abortion, one only. But yeah, she's your friend and she's asking, madam, ab kya karu? So how you will advise, what is the role of anesthetic gases and the role of other environmental toxins? And then I will come back to Richa about her answer. Yeah.
Now you have written here, this old anesthetist is 33 years old. And secondly, her OT is very heavy. So she must be having a lot of stress, one thing. So stress is also associated with recurrent pregnancy loss. So though there is no evidence, but definitely one factor is stress. That I'm coming next. The increased risk of pregnancy loss when you are exposed to anesthetic gases in the operating and recovery rooms as well, as compared to non-exposed hospital staff. So not only anesthetist, all the people who are working there, residents, and everybody is exposed. So there are various studies on the medical literature and they talk about this waste anesthetic gases. But nowadays what has happened is there are good scavenging systems. So I have to counsel her that it may be associated with some amount of spontaneous abortion, so she can avoid general anesthetics. The main culprits are nitrous oxide or halothane, which we were using earlier. But now there is WAG, what we call it as a waste anesthetic gas, the designs of the boils machine, everything, the working station, everything has changed. So definitely we can reduce the exposure by working into the different workstations.
Will you advise her the rest from the OT? I mean, she should take posting in the
ward. Not like radiology. She can just avoid the stress factor, one thing. And wherever the high dosages are associated, means more than 4 ppm or something like that, she can avoid those operation theaters where it is very heavy OT and mainly the general anesthesia is given.
Yeah. Thank you, Vidya. Now I will go back to Richa. Richa, yes, we were talking about metformin and how you will manage the case of PCO who comes to you with recurrent pregnancy loss. Richa, are you with me? Richa? Raki, is she with us? Because I can't see the full screen. I'm sharing my screen. Richa?
She is there. That time she was having connectivity issue as soon as she came back also.
Achha. And now?
Richa? I'll just give a call to her.
Yeah, just give a call and just interrupt us. I will go to the rapid fire round for our esteemed panelist. Garima, this is for you. Is there a male factor? And if yes, mention one test you will advise to this couple.
Yeah, so this is a less addressed factor that we, as soon as the patient comes, we are more inclined to investigate the women. So the most important is that the male factor is direct and indirect. The indirect causes have been very beautifully covered by Dr. Vidya about smoking, alcohol, obesity.
My camera is open.
Yeah.
I can see myself on screen. But I can see myself on the screen.
Richa, you are talking?
Richa, I can see myself. I'm there on the screen.
You close down your video, then your audio will be better.
नहीं रिचा मोनिका काइंडली अलाउ रिचा मेक हर को होस्ट ना बिकॉज शी इज नॉट एबल टू अनम्यूट हर सेल्फ एंड नॉर शी इज एबल टू ओपन द वीडियो दैट इज द प्रॉब्लम
मैम शी इज अ को होस्ट ना या गुड सो लेट अस फिनिश विद गरिमा एंड देन आई विल गो बैक टू रिचा यस गरिमा
Okay, so the indirect causes of even the obesity in the male partner, the smoking and alcohol, these are some things, and also the occupation of the male. So if they are having very stressful jobs, these are the indirect causes that can affect the couple as a whole and can lead to abortions. But the direct causes are that usually we don't go for a, as Dr. Sita has told, that there may be various other factors. So if there is any chromosomal hint of any chromosomal anomaly, like there is any hint of any chromosomally anomalous baby in the family, or any male member or female member of the family are suffering from any disorders, then in that case, or there is history of early pregnancy losses, that is early first trimester abortion before 8 weeks, blighted ovum, these all gives hint to genetic factors.
Yes, yeah. Can you advise DFI? Is there any role of DFI?
No, direct, no, we don't apply
any fragmentation test.
We don't advise it routinely. We don't apply.
So, in these cases of RPL for the male partner, you will not advise routinely.
Routinely we don't advise.
So, male factor is definitely there, as Dr. Garima has highlighted. You have to ask in your history taking an examination about the direct and indirect causes. Richa, I am coming back to you. We left here. How will you counsel her and manage this case of PCOS who has come to you with RPL?
So, we have to, the counseling main part is we have to explain her that she has to do her weight loss by her lifestyle modification, her diet, regular exercise, which is going to bring her reduce her insulin resistance as well as reduce her hyperandrogenemia, and along with it we will keep her on metformin in pre-conceptional period. It has a role in bringing about a weight loss in obese PCOS, and at the same time we will cover rest factors also. We'll give her vitamin D supplements. And then when she conceives, when her test is positive, then the role of metformin is controversial. Recommendation, any strong recommendation is not there, though there are many studies where they say that continuation of metformin up to 6 months is helpful for insulin resistance. And because these are the cases who are later likely to develop gestational diabetes or preeclampsia, and even preterm delivery. So mostly it depends upon the choice of the clinician. If they want, they can continue metformin because no adverse effect has also been reported with the use of
metformin. Is the recommended dose of metformin?
If she's already, we begin it with 500 milligram and then take it to 1000 milligram BD. So if she's already on metformin, we can continue her previous dose, that is 1000 milligram BD. Yeah. And then further, we know that there are many other factors also, like vitamin D deficiency or hyperhomocysteinemia, which has to be corrected before conception in such a case with recurrent pregnancy losses. And then androgen, as we will improve her androgen levels, her endometrial receptivity will also increase. If needed, we can give her a progesterone support in early pregnancy.
Very well said, Richa. So you have given clear-cut take-home messages to the participants about the management of PCO who comes to you with RPL. So now let us go to our rapid fire, and this is really rapid fire, Richa. Will you advise torch in case of recurrent pregnancy loss?
Torch does not have any role in recurrent pregnancy loss, though it may have a role in isolated miscarriages. So excellent. We need to see whether our patient, what were the history on investigations of the patient who had this miscarriage. Was the baby abnormal in the form of hydrops or had some brain lesions, or the baby had IUGR, or was there an history of any fever with rashes in the patient in the, and in which trimester, that is also important. So as in RPL, it has no role, but yes, in isolated pregnancy losses, it does have a role.
Yes, excellent, teacher, because many patients, they come to us with the report of IgG, IgM, and they tell us that doctor has told them that you should not get pregnant till your reports are negative. So IgG remains positive for her entire lifetime, and IgM does remain positive for 1 or 2 years. So if she is pregnant, please do avidity test and accordingly manage, but don't tell them a point blank that you should not conceive till your IgM or IgG becomes negative. So Vidya, can diabetes contribute to RPL?
I must say that uncontrolled diabetes, yes.
Yes.
But if it is well controlled, no. But always there is insulin resistance, and there are various factors. Already we talked about PCOS and insulin metabolism, and many of these patients are already on metformin.
Yes.
So routinely, osteogen, other guidelines, they don't say that routinely you screen for diabetes.
No, but our DIPSI guidelines tells us to definite. But Vidya, our DIPSI guidelines tells us to do at the first antenatal visit.
Antenatal visit, but this I am talking about other guidelines.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
Diabetes per se, well controlled, does not contribute.
Yes,
uncontrolled does.
Yes, Anahita, 50% of cases they do remain unexplained because we can't find the cause. So, what you will do? What is the role of tender loving care?
So here, I think one aspect which we have not addressed today is the immunological aspect of RPL.
Yes.
And coming from Mumbai, we do have Dr. Mohan and Mugda Rao, who actually have an immunological treatment for RPL, where I would say in a very small proportion of cases, it may be of benefit, paternal leukocyte infusions and so on. The point that Dr. Jaideep Tank made in his talk is that we do tend to empirically also give progesterone as a part of our tender loving care package to these women. But I'm not a believer of bed rest or any other restriction to prevent a recurrent miscarriage. But progesterone, yes, I do believe that that will have a role to play. And as Sita also said, genetic factors may be investigated when we really don't have anything else in the unexplained basket.
Yes, Anahita, you have given a very clear-cut take-home message that in this 50% unexplained, if we really investigate them and do advanced tests, there are chances that we will be able to find out the cause and treat them. Yes. Very true. Sita, can decreased ovarian reserve contribute to RPL? Because day in and day out, we are seeing these cases more often.
No, actually, there is no evidence to say that decreased ovarian reserves contribute to RPL. It can obviously cause problems in conceiving, but once they conceive, it does not actually cause any problems in losing that pregnancy. So you shouldn't base our treatment on that.
Yes, Kiran Mai, hypothyroidism, because this is also very important.
Yes.
Many of our women are hypothyroid, so can it contribute to RPL?
Yes, definitely the ESHRAE guidelines and other guidelines say that this is one of the important correctable factors. Very clear, not subclinical. Subclinical, there is not much evidence to say that correction of subclinical hypothyroidism is going to treat RPL. But definitely if there is overt hypothyroidism, we have to treat it preconceptionally. Otherwise, we have to, I mean, if there is any doubt and anything else, then we have to repeat it at around 7 to 9 weeks. Then if the TSH is high, definitely treatment is going to, I mean, if it is uncorrected, it is going may cause RPL. So definitely hypothyroidism has to be treated.
Yes, Kiranmay, you have rightly said the Indian Thyroid Society and our own FOXI recommends universal thyroid screening at the first antenatal visit. And if she comes to us for preconception counseling, or if she is a case of infertility, we do investigate her for thyroid. And friends, it is very easy to remember the cutoffs of TSH, because during preconception, it is 2.5 if she's trying to conceive. First trimester 2.5, second and third 3. So this is our cutoff. routinely for those who are not interested in pregnancy or they are not pregnant, the cutoff given by the labs is usually more than 4, 4.5 or 4.5 to normal. But for these patients, the cutoff is really different. So just remember 2.5, 2.5, 3 and 3. Now, coming to the end of this panel, I would like to have the one-line take-home message from all the panelists for our participants, starting from Garima. Garima?
So my message is that this panel was a very extensive panel, which has touched and discussed every aspect of it. So we should, whenever a patient comes with RPL, first and foremost thing that we should have a very positive attitude towards them.
Great.
He as an obstetrician should not look like confused or anxious to the patient. Whatever the cause may be, we will be able to treat her. And if the cause is not known, we know that there is 50% chance of pregnancy. So we should always give a positive attitude, tender loving care, good antenatal care, and she will have a live child.
Great. Richa? Unmute karo, Richa.
Reassurance, and then telling them that the chances of repetition are very less. What is important in this is that whether the previous loss there was a presence of cardiac activity or not, because many of our causes we can make out whether it was a missed abortion or whether then it was any chromosomal defect or an embryonic pregnancy. So that history is very important. And besides that, all the factors which we have discussed, the hormonal factors, the anatomical factors, all these have to taken into consideration.
Richa, you have rightly said that detailed history taking will really give you a clue that in which direction you should go ahead as far as your tests are concerned. Kiran Mai?
Yeah, the one thing is RPL needs to have a committed separate clinics. I mean, not in the rush hour clinics where we are not able to give time. So the first visit itself should take, you know, the whole history, and they tend to have a lot of records, reports with them. So that is one thing. And second thing is, ordering unnecessary investigations, as Anahita Madam was telling about thrombophilia screening and all. We do see so many investigations which are not warranted and all.
Baby routinely advises torch panel. Yeah, torch. If patient is affording thrombophilia, then the APLA, and they come to us with the such big files and the reports.
We get lost.
Yes, we get lost because some of the they give really some very funny reports as far as torch and these things are concerned. So very rightly said, as Dr. Anahita has already said, keep do only those tests where you know how to interpret them and when they are really indicated. So Anahita, carry forward to you. What is your take-home message?
So I think the previous panelists have almost covered all the points, but I have two diametrically different things to say. One is, of course, do not criticize what your predecessor has done.
Great.
Because we will always have patients coming to us for a second, third, fourth, and opinion. And it is, you know, the few bad words which may come out of our mouth or loose words may actually also impact the couple psychologically. Yeah. So even if on this forum we are saying that we do see reports which are unindicated and a whole stack of them, don't criticize your colleagues. At the other end of the spectrum, know your limitations and know when to involve either a hematologist or some other expert in
detail. Immunologist, genetic counselors. You are absolutely right, Araita. We should not look lost. If we don't know how to manage them, it is high time that we take help of our colleagues who are specialized in that particular condition. Sita, your take home?
Again, most of it is covered, but I would just give a practical point. As Kiran Mai said, these people, you need to give them time and counseling. There's a lot. Hear them out because they have so many experiences, so many traumatic experiences. So give them time to hear them out. If they have a huge pack of file, if you don't have the time, ask them to leave that in your clinic, go through it in your, you say, I will go through it in my leisure time, and then call them back rather than having a rushed conversation with them and they not being satisfied with you. So that's one practical take home. And secondly, justify justify your investigations. Just don't do it because you have to do it. Justify each investigation. Explain to them why you're doing it and what will be the action if something comes out of it. So, you know, give them time. Time is most crucial.
You rightly said, because I do that routinely in my practice. I tell them, please keep your reports with me and I will go at my leisure time, because you really have to go through page by page, because sometimes they come to us with very costly reports which we don't like to repeat. So very well taken your point, Sita. Now Vidya, final take-home message. Yes.
Yeah. Really, it was a wonderful panel. I must thank Lakshmi and all the panelists. It was a really take-home messages are also very nice. I must say that we always talk of healthy lifestyle, then healthy eating and the nutrition, everything we talk vaguely. So we don't give them correctly what they should eat, what vitamin supplementation they should take many times. And sometimes we have to talk with the family also. We never talk with the husband. Only the lady comes in and we are talking with her only. So many times the paternal factors are also there, sperms and other things are also there. So those things we just avoid talking into. So the family counseling is also important, and the correct lifestyle with minimal exposure to, as we were talking, the profession wise also anesthetist or radiologist, or the mainly we talk of stress. So another factor of yoga and meditation also comes. So we never touch those aspects of this one. And this tender loving care at the end, at the all recurrent pregnancy losses, we talk of tender loving care. But what does it really means? What woman wants, what love she wants, from she whom wants she, wants.
She wants. She wants your time. She wants your patient hearing.
Doctor talks n number of things, but after going home, she has to face herself.
Yes.
So really, what is the definition of this tender loving care? They say that every time you do scan and show their heartbeats and the baby's well. But after going home, if the mother-in-law is shouting and my husband is shouting that repeated losses are there, then it is really, it is not worth.
Actually, they need the help of professional psychologists.
Absolutely.
The professional counselors.
It's a huge guilt factor.
Yes.
Yeah.
Instead of being counseling,
Like adolescent clinics, one should have this recurrent pregnancy loss clinics, so that the counselor plays a major role in that. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks a lot, my dear all esteemed panelists, you for your wonderful take-home messages. And thank you, Rakhi, for giving us all this opportunity to conduct a panel on recurrent pregnancy loss.
On behalf of all the panelists,
thank you,
Lakshmi, for doing a lovely job.
Fantastic.
Thank you all the panelists and
Dr. Lakshmi.
Thank you.
And it was indeed a panel which was discussed at length, from the causes to the management part, and how to preserve and how to send the sample for testing, which is most important, which most of us forget at times. And by mistake, it is sent in formalin, which is very important that we need not send it in that, and it needs to be sent in saline, which is very important. And all the take-home messages were indeed good. And formally, I would like to give a thanks to from three committees of us listening together: the endocrine committee, the public awareness committee, and young talent promotion. I would like to extend my vote of thanks on behalf of Kalyan Barmed and Niharika.
Kalyan joined.
From all three of us, I would like to extend my thanks to Dr. Samta Gupta, Dr. Armina Samant, Dr. Jaydeep Tank, and Dr. Lakshmi, with all the great panelists along Dr. Vidya, Dr. Kiran Mai, Sita Ramamurthy, Dr. Anhaita, Dr. Garima, and Dr. Richa, for being there for this academic feast today. And I would like to thank Dr. Shanta Kumari, the President Foxy, the Vice President Dr. Basak, for being there with us for this program today, and our academic partners, Zydus, for giving us this academic grant and the platform for us. Thank you, one and all, for making the day a great one.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Again, the same format of academic program on 1st of November, again from 7 to 9 p.m. Definitely, all of us would be there again. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.
Great seeing you all.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
It was a great panel. Yeah. Thank you.